Good evening, everyone. I am Satyam here, and today we have Mr. Jitesh Gurnani from Bharati Vidyapeeth. He is doing his internship, and today he'll be talking about the dispensing of progressive Edison lenses. So, I welcome you, Jitesh.
Thank you, Satyam. Good evening, everyone. First of all, thank you for Optum team for giving me this opportunity. Today I'm going to talk about the art of dispensing progressive addition lenses. Any financial interest, I do not promote any brand or discourage any brand. This content is only for study purpose only. So if we look through the gun sights of progressive vision correction, then we will see that they are the goals of refractive correcting device is to provide optimum vision. Now if we talk about what is optimum vision means the vision which we see through the eyes having no refractive correcting device in front of it. That means what are the expectations we have from a vision correcting device, refractive device? It is nothing but it should provide negligible amount of deviation from the natural vision. So these all are the few options available for age group of presbyopia: single vision lenses, bifocals, progressive addition lenses, and multifocal lenses. Single vision lenses, it corrects only one distance at a time. That means, as the name itself indicates, that the patient has to have two different pair of spectacles. One will work for his distance vision and the other one will work for reading purpose or the near vision. And that is why it becomes inconvenient, especially if the patient is having ametropia, like myopia or hypermetropia, then again he should have a distance correction and near correction separately. So it becomes cumbersome and becomes unmanageable. If we talk about bifocals have a distinct junction between zones that becomes cosmetically unappealing. Because of absence of intermediate segment, it provides intermediate blur. And because of the visible segment that is available in between distance and near, this segment, whenever the wearer switches his vision from distance to near, the patient experiences image jump. We will discuss in detail about image jump as well. Before that, we just quickly see about the available bifocal options. The first one is this. You can see my pointer. This one is D28. D, because the D, letter D, the segment resembles the shape of D. D28 means segment is having 28 mm wide. This is executive bifocal, where the optical center of near generally is placed on the segment top. Then D35, the only difference between D28 and D35 is the segment is wider in case of flat top or D35. Around 22, that is cryptog by 22 mm. Image jump. The consequences of image jump are as follows: scotoma. See, when the patient jumps from distance vision to near vision, he just have to move his eyes through the segment top as well. The ray one indicates, let me switch on the pointer. See, ray one indicates the scotoma, the ray that passes through the segment top, and ray two indicates the just when the patient enters into the near segment, the ray 2 is deviated towards the base, because the mini lens, the addition power, is nothing but a plus lens with a base down prismatic effect. And we all know that a lens have a prism always deviates the rays towards its base. So you can see that ray 2 is deviated towards the base of the plus lens, the additional lens. And hence, the area between ray 1 and ray 2 indicates the area of scotoma. Because of this scotomas area, the patient misses some amount of information. This is the first consequence of image jump. The second consequence is the apparent displacement of the object as the eye crosses top edge of the segment. See, there is slight displacement, as you can see in the letter E, it is slightly apparently displaced. That is why the patient may the patient may report symptoms like there is digging appearance when he uses bifocals and looks through the staircase or walks through the staircase. So in that case, there is apparent displacement of the object. Next comes in the segment about the today's topic, that is progressive adhesion lenses. Progressive adhesion lenses overcomes all the disadvantages which we have in single vision and bifocals. They provide uninterrupted vision for all distances. The reason is the availability of intermediate zone, the corridor, which we can call it as. Corridor means there is a progression of power given from distance to near that allows the wearer to focus at different distances ranging from 6 meters to 30 or 40 centimeters, for which near vision is prescribed. Also, it do not have any visible junctions. That is why it becomes cosmetically appealing. It is very convenient because a single pair of spectacles work for every distances. It do not have differential displacement, again because of absence of the visible junction. That itself is a consequence of image jump in case of bifocals. So this is a simulated vision. A patient will look through a progressive adhesion lens. You can see the farthest away infrastructure. This building indicates the distance vision. The trees, the shadows of the trees on the road, these resembles the intermediate vision. The book, the reading area indicates the near vision. And as you can see that all the distances are well covered through a progressive adhesion lens. This is how a patient will look through a progressive adhesion lens. But you all can also see that there is a blur zone in the periphery. As you can see, the water jug, the food items, the coffee mug is from the area of blur zone. This is what the disadvantage of a progressive adhesion lens is. So if we talk about what defines the unwanted peripheral blur, this can be explained on the basis of Minkowitz theorem. Astigmatism perpendicular to the power vertex line changes twice as quickly as the rate of change of power along the vertex line. In simpler words, we can say that the horizontal astigmatism, unwanted astigmatism, will be the double amount of progression given at that point. For example, if a lens plano adhesion to lens progressive lens is there, so horizontally across near reference circle, you can see that you can expect plus four diopter of astigmatism, because double the amount of plus two is plus four. Similarly, at the intermediate point, just at the intermediate point, that is, if a plano adhesion two lens is there, then intermediate point is expected to have an adhesion of plus one. So horizontal across that point of vertex line, you can expect plus two diopter, double the plus one diopter of astigmatism, that is plus two diopter of astigmatism across the horizontal point surrounding the intermediate point. So there's a paper published in American Academy of Optometry, which concludes that zone widths can deviate considerably from the Minkowitz theorem at location along the corridor. But every zone width along the entire corridor approximate Minkowitz theorem. This means whenever the lens was made, marketed and tested, it is seen that Minkowitz theorem failed to apply. But overall, it was true, but at a single point, like I have told about intermediate point in plano adhesion two lens, it was expected that plus two diopter of astigmatism at the point of surrounding the point of intermediate was expected, but it was not true. It was more or less, but not plus two. So there was a potential concept of modified Minkowitz theorem, which again is which just added one point, that is, it is true for infinitesimal distance from the vertex line. Now, in further slide, we will see that what infinitesimal distance is, why modified Minkowitz theorem was provided. So before that, we must know the limitations of Minkit theorem, original Minkit theorem. There are three major limitations. Minkit theorem can only be applied to a surface where the vertex line has astigmatism of 0 diopters, exactly 0 diopters. And most of the progressive lenses that are in market now allow some level of astigmatism in the vertex line. That may be 0.12 or lesser than 0.12 diopter of astigmatism, but yet there is amount of astigmatism available in the or along the vertex line. So this was the very first limitation of original Minkit theorem. You can see this pointer, the red line that passes through the corridor from distance to near is a vertex line. So it is expected that this vertex line is free of astigmatism, but in practice it was not proven true. So first limitation. Second, it is true only for an infinitesimal distance from the corridor. Now, if we search for literal meaning of infinitesimal distance, that means a distance which is very, very less or near to zero. That means just surrounding the vertex line, the corridor, it is true. But as we can see that in Minkit theorem, we were expecting that if a plano addition, to consider this lens as a plano addition to lens, so at the pointer where my pointer is, you can expect plus one addition because this is an intermediate point. So we were expecting the each and every point of horizontal line, you can see my pointer moving across this double a plus one diopter of astigmatism, but this was not true. This is only the Minkit theorem is only applied to an infinitesimal distance that is very less. Even my pointer is quite bigger than that. So this was the second limitation. Third, and the last, which is very easy to understand, Minkit theorem does not apply to most of the progressive lenses that are commercialized nowadays. And this refers to the fact that Minkit theorem only can be applied to lenses with no inset. See, mark this word no inset, which means that the lenses where the near zone is shifted horizontally are excluded. See, nowadays you can see that these type of lenses, progressive lenses are available. These type of progressive lenses are not available. The only difference is of inset. Previously, these type of lenses were available, and the fitter needs to rotate the lens according to the near PD to provide the inset, and hence lateral aberrations created a dramatic problem over distance and near as well to the patient. While to enhance the performance of the progressive addition lens, we came up with asymmetrical design. This was a symmetrical design. If you divide these lens across vertical line, you can get two equal mirror images, while this you cannot. This is an asymmetrical design. So the basic thing is Minkit theorem is not true for these asymmetrical designs, while it is true for symmetrical designs, which are not available nowadays. So just keeping theoretical part aside, coming to the practical aspect as the topic revolves around it. So if progressives have much, much advantage, why they are not prescribed much often? So this can be explained on the basis of love and hate relationship with progressives. If anyone have gone through the rate list of a progressive addition lens, you might have seen that the progressive addition lens of a reputed brand with similar level of treatments compared to single vision and bifocals is much, much costlier than single vision and bifocals. So we love the revenue generated, but when the patient comes back with the problems, we hate all that things. But we must know that this is what a thin line between optician and optometrist is. Optician just hate that thing, but we as an optometrist can turn that hate relationship when the patient comes back with troubles to leverage to our practice. There are certain pitfalls for all the available options for presbyopia. Single vision, we have seen that it is cumbersome to switch between two pair of spectacles. Bifocal, there is very heavy optical disadvantage of image jump. Similar goes with progressives, but it is very lesser in as compared to previous two options. So what are the pitfalls of progressives? It has unwanted surface astigmatism, which generally we cannot ignore. It is there, it comes with unwanted surface astigmatism, we have to adapt to it. So it also possesses adaptation problems. It requires very sensorious fitting because just even a single mm decentration of pupillary distance or fitting heights, all these things will create a dramatic change and may cause trouble to the patient. Definitely, it comes with big budget, but it is worthy of it. So, dispensing progressives, by all these things, we can say this, that prescribing or dispensing progressives is an art. Why? Because it requires fair training and education. Fair training, the more you are trained with the progressives, the more handouts you have done with the progressives, it will be very easy to go further in case of progressives. It requires very high communication skills because in this case, patient is expecting that you must know what expectations the patient are coming up with, and you must provide the exact outcome what the patient is demanding. Then guiding and directional skills are very important. Sometimes patient comes up with the expectations of seventh sky, that I require everything from a single lens. This is not true. Even in not in only case of progressives, but in case of contact lens as well, or single vision as well, everything has certain limitations. So we require very proper and smooth guiding and directional skills so that we can guide and provide direction to our patients. And it definitely encouraging ability is very important in this case, because you need to encourage, you need to tell that the expectations are true or not the patient which he has come up with. So according to that, we need to select for design. We should not forget that it is only an art. It is a branch of science as well. Dispensing progressives is a science as well. It requires a systematic approach. If even a single point, if we just deviate through, it will come up with the problems, definitely. So we must go through a systematic approach. We must comprehend the probable troubles the patient can come up with. We must know what are the possible troubles and what will be solution to that. We require detailed knowledge of available designs, because designs are available starting from the low end spectrum of economy and to the high end spectrum of economy. So according to the need, according to the requirement, as per his occupation, as per his hobbies and as per his needs, you must just select the designs, and for that you must have detailed knowledge of available designs. This is a sketch of a progressive addition lens. This image indicates the temporary markings, and the right one indicates the permanent one. Temporary markings, you have seen this. This is a fitting cross which is expected to be exactly at the center of pupil while the patient is looking through distance. Then DRP, distance reference point. Here we expect to check the distance power, which is generally 4 mm upward to fitting cross, but it is not mandatory that it will be 4 mm only, like in case of products with Zeiss. I again remind that I do not possess any financial interest with any brand, but in case of Zeiss, it is not 4 mm, it is 6 mm. In certain brands, it differs. So theoretical, we have read that it is 4 mm upwards. It is not always true in case of practice. PRP is prism reference point. Here we can check the prism which we have prescribed, which is grounded on the lens, or if not, thinning prisms are used. So we can check that on prism reference point. It serves as an important landmark for the corridor beginning. Here the progression of power begins. Then NRP, near reference point. Here the patient is expected to see through this circle while looking through near, and we can check near power on this point as well. ARM, alignment reference mark. Alignment reference mark serves as an important point that the lens is not rotated or tilted even a bit. These lines needed to be aligned with the horizontal eye wire, horizontal rim of the frame, so that it is ensured that lens is fitted exactly on the axis prescribed. This is a permanent markings where there are two micro etchings on nasal side. There is logo. Sometimes logo itself serves as a micro etching. And on the left, on the temporal side, there is addition engraved. there are certain companies which uses different methods to engrave the addition, like in case of Stellar, if they have to engrave 1.75, then they engrave 17 initial two without dots. 1.7 indicates 1.75 addition, while in case of Zeiss, it engraves entire 2.25, like 2.25, so it engraves 2 to 5. We must not forget that micro etchings are permanent markings. These are 34 mm apart. This distance is very important to recreate the temporary markings and hence recheck if it is erased. The prism reference point is generally bifurcates equally these two micro etchings, which will become 17 mm apart. These are the real photographs. As you can see, this is a Zeiss logo pointer at the pointer. It is engraved L3V50. L3V is a product name, light 3DV. 50 indicates the material used by this lens, 1.50. It may be 60. That means it indicates that the material of the lens is MR8, 1.60. Right now, this real photograph was taken of a lens having 1.50 index. The product was light 3DV. And on the right side of the image, you can see the Zeiss logo itself serves as a micro etching, and 2 to 5 indicates that the addition is of 2.25. This is all a summary which is approved by ISO and ANSI. These are the markings, the reference markings. It is written that it may be removable or permanent. We all have gone through this in the previous slides. These are the aberrations which I use. Just go through it quickly so that we must go in the further slides. Okay. So if we talk about the suitability, the suitable candidates for progressives, it comes that all the presbyopes are the suitable candidates, no doubt. But just we need to consider the challenges. Challenges are very important to be considered in case of progressives. See, these are the three major challenges: field of view, direction of gaze, ocular motility. Field of view means the area which is visible through the lens at any point. Generally, it is considered for the near point only. So when the patient looks through the lens from the near zone, it is expected that the widest field of view is provided. So depending upon that, designs are available, harder and softer designs. Market availability doesn't come with hard design or soft design as such. Market designs are as per product names. In the availability section, we will discuss it in further slides. But in the theoretical books, we might have gone that the harder designs have this area and softer designs has lesser distance and near, while wider corridor width. So this is true, but the names are different. It is not like hard and soft in the market availability. So field of view are the challenges. We must know that whatever the patient expectations are met with the selected design or not, or else we need to change the design. Next, direction of gaze and ocular motility runs hand in hand. The thing is, direction of gaze means the position, the gaze at which the patient is looking, and the ocular motility means the amount of ocular rotations, the eye movements he is doing to look at that gaze. Like this lady is looking to this side, so she is moving eyes as well. So you can see that this portion will have peripheral blur. So this eye might land up into vision, which is looking through a peripheral blur. So it is very important to know, to make your patient aware that in case of progressive, if you are an eye mover more than head movers, you must train them to shift towards head movement, or else you must select the design which is suitable for them so that the peripheral blur is shifted across the extreme periphery so that they must not pose any difficulties. These are the basic designs, hard and soft designs. See, you can all see that there is intense amount of peripheral astigmatism, but as a reward on that, there is wider distance and wider near zone, but the amount of astigmatism is quite intense. So the patient will feel extreme blur if the patient moves his eyes through this zone. While in case of softer design, you can see the intensity of astigmatism is quite less, but on cost of narrowing the distance and near zone, but on a reward of getting wider, bit wider intermediate zone. So for example, if a patient is a car driver, you must go with harder designs because he has to see more wider distance zone. While if a patient is a computer user, more often a computer user is working for more than 4 or 5 hours on a computer screen, you must go with softer designs because then it will have wider intermediate zone. But you must tell both the advantages and disadvantages of both the designs as well, because then if a computer user is selecting a softer design, he must not expect wider distance or wider near. Similar vice versa goes with harder designs as well. So just coming to fitting progressives, we must identify the patient's requirements and expectations. For that, we must judge the motivation of the patient, and we must call the attention of the patient to advantages, but never forget to mention the limitations as well. We must see the patient, feel what his expectations are, judge accordingly, and make the patient aware that these certain expectations will be fulfilled and these certain expectations will not. Even if we select progressives or we select bifocals, these are the advantage of one over other, and accordingly act. Frame selection plays a very vital role in this case. We must prefer metal frames because they have adjustable nose pads. That itself is a key to solve majority of troubles the patient can come up with. We will see in the further troubleshooting slides that how metal frames have more advantage over plastic frames. But we all know that the trend advocates the preference of over metal frames, but yet we must let the patient know, or otherwise we must train ourselves that much that plastic frames do not possess any troubles after dispensing. If we talk about the frame profile, frame shape, it should have a good shape. The aviators from the traditional times are considered to be as a bad shape because it allows the near portion that is cut off due to the aviator shape, slanting shape. Then frame depth should be adequate. Good, it should not have insufficient depth. Otherwise, for the basic reason which the patient is buying progressives, that is in presence of intermediate zone optical benefit, it will be washed off or it will not give the maximum advantage. Also, the other reason is the shorter the corridor of the progressive, the more intense will be the astigmatism, because manufacturer has to arrange the peripheral astigmatism there only. So we must think this in mind. So generally in practice, we just ask for longer depth, longer B size frames, so that this have adequate depth. If we talk about frame size, it should be good, adequate size. It should not be too large, again, because larger frames will have more amount of astigmatism in the periphery, which will cause problems to the patient. In the figure, it is depicted by blue lines. You can see that the larger frame, if we choose, we have a wide, a stronger peripheral unwanted astigmatism. So frame adjustments, there are three parameters which are very, very important while considering progressive dispensing. Back vertex distance. See, this is back vertex distometer. It is calibrated for 2 mm, for compensation of 2 mm thickness of eyelid. So one arm of the instrument is kept on the closed eyelid, and this switch is pressed so that the other leg places on the back surface of the lens, and hence the reading comes. This pointer indicates the reading, how much will be the back vertex distance. We must know that it should be as short as possible, because shortening the back vertex distance will make the frame closer to the cornea, and hence the wider the field of view. But keep in mind that the eyelash should not touch the spectacle lens, otherwise it will be very difficult to wear. Second parameter is pentascopic tilt. Generally, the frames in our inventory are 10 to 12 degrees pentascopic tilt adjusted. This is a pentascopic tilt measuring tool. It is just placed perpendicular to the, parallel to the frame front. And accordingly, the pointer indicates the pentascopic tilt. In this case, you might see that there it is at 10 degrees, and which is expected. 10 to 12 degrees of pentascopic tilt is expected. What is the importance of pentascopic tilt? That the giving pentascopic tilt will move this near portion closer to the eye, because near portion contains addition, which is plus power compared to distance power. So more plus power will be, it will have lesser field of view because of magnification. You know that magnification and field of view are inversely proportional. If you increase magnification, field of view decreases. So to enhance the field of view, you must have sufficient amount of pentascopic tilt so that the patient have wider field of view as well. So these two parameters, back vertex distance, BVD, and pentascopic tilt, these two are on the basis, on the concept of if. So third parameter is facial wrap or wrap angle. It should not be excessively flat to avoid the unwanted reflections on the frame. If anything, any refractive element is just flat, so you will see that there are unwanted reflections and hence transmission is decreased. To measure facial wrap, there is a book guided tool. You just have to keep the one eye wire of the any one eye wire of the frame just on the reference line, and the other eye wire will turn and will indicate the degrees of facial wrap in degrees. Here in this case, it is 15 degrees. We must know that these all adjustments are okay. These all measurements are okay, but before that, frame adjustments are very, very important. If the frame is tightened on the face of wearer, you must loose it first, and vice versa. If it is sliding in front of the nose, you must adjust that first. Sometimes what happens, the patient asks that he will wear his spectacle slightly forward on the nose, not exactly at the nose bridge. So that is to be considered previously before taking all these measurements, because then measurements will definitely differ and will cause dramatic changes in the outcomes. Also, sometimes we need to do these things at the time of dispensing as well, if the patient comes up with the trouble. Next, it is the extremely important parameter, PD measurement, pupillary distance measurement. You must measure the PD monocularly. Do not, You must know that monocular distance PDs are very important. It should not be measured binocularly, because then the patient may be exotropic, azotropic, or generally the patient's PD are not similar to one another. Like in this case, the PD of this eye is 29 mm and this eye is 31 mm. So if you take binocular PD, the outcome will be 60 mm, but in this case, monocular PDs differ. So accordingly, the outcome will differ of a progressive lens. There was a study published in some paper I have read that says that even 1 mm decentration causes 20% magnification or minification changes, and hence will cause very difficulties to the patient. We must also not forget to take near PDs. Generally, which we do forget, because while looking near, the eye rotates and causes convergence, which generally decreases the PD by 2 mm. So manufacturers, if we do not provide near PDs, generally manufacturers, what does they do? From the distance PDs of each eye separately, they detect 2 mm. Like in this case, if you do not provide near PD, the near PD will be taken as 27 mm, 29 minus 2 mm. So that should not be in the real practice, although it is existing, but we must consider the near PD measurement as well. Because sometimes you do not know that the patient is near esotropic or near accommodative esotropic, like that conditions, in which near PDs does not make 2 mm detection from distance PDs. Next, fitting height. Fitting height, sorry. Sorry, there was a call. Fitting height means the horizontal line of the fitting cross, the vertical distance from the center of the fitting cross to the bevel of lens indicates the fitting height. So this fitting height should be measured in natural head posture, exactly sitting at the same level of the eye, so that to avoid parallax errors, you just need to use white pencils, because that do not only glaze over the lens like markers do, and they also have we can easily erase that white pencil in case of mistakes as well. While in case of markers, we need to use acetone that may damage the frame material and may cause irritation to the eye if it goes inside. So fitting height, there are two ways to measure and mark fitting height or fitting cross. Simply, fitting height is nothing but the horizontal component of the fitting cross indicates about fitting height, and the vertical component of the fitting cross indicates about the pupillary distance. So we can mark it just if we are experienced and trained enough, we can just mark over the frame on the patient's eyes as well. But if there are some doubts, just take the pupillary distance manually or photographic methods or pupillary centric methods, pupillometers, and just take the fitting height like this scale comes to you, like fitting height measuring scales. Then keep the frame exactly centric to the diagonally centric lines. Bridge should be exactly center to that in the fitting layout chart. And vertical line mark will indicate the PD, monocular PD, and the horizontal line mark will indicate the fitting height. These all are the calibrated fitting height measurements. Like in this case, you have seen that 23 mm. So exactly keeping this on 23 mm, shifting the frame up and down, you can mark it. And according to that, if the fitting cross is marked, then keep the frame on this center and choose the diameter of the lens. The maximum, choose the minimum possible diameter, but consider that the entire eye wire is surrounded in that diameter of the lens, so that after cutting, it should not cut off in the frame. Or if we talk about ordering progressives, we must provide certain parameters like A size, B size. A size is this, B size is this. Distance between lenses or bridge size. Fitting height, which we have already taken. Monocular PDs taken. Near PDs taken. Base curve. Base curve is taken by this lens gauze. It is easier to provide base curve, and it will be easier for the manufacturer to provide to come up with the certain specific base curves, and will easy in the fitting as well. Then pentoscopic tilt, wrap angle, frame type and shape, the profile which we have selected should also be provided in certain manufacturers. Like in case of Zeiss, if we order, there comes the software on the computer or through which we order the lenses. Depict certain shapes, and we just need to select, mouse click the shape which resembles the choose plastic frame. It should be metal, or it should be metal frames. It can be supra three piece or the manual full frames. So according to that, the frame selection should be done. Then lens product, material, coatings, diameter, thickness. In case of coatings, treatment should also be considered, that the patient require tinted lenses. Sometimes patient asked to wear the progressives outdoors as a sunglasses. So in that case, we just need to tint the lens as a sunglasses. Then we also sometimes need to make the lenses polaroid. We can also make the lenses photochromic. So these treatments or coatings should also be mentioned in the ordering form. After that, we must go through the quality check. As soon as the pair of spectacles are ready to us, we must go through the quality checks. What are things, what things which we need to be checked for are distance power, near power, prisms, and scratches and coatings. This is very important factor which the patient will see after you handle the pair of new pair of lenses, a new pair of spectacles to him, that if there are certain scratches or coatings, he might not accept the lenses. So before handling, before calling the patient so that he comes and pick the spectacles, you must check all these things very thoroughly. Then do not erase the temporary markings. I'll let you know that why it is important. While delivering, what happens, we just need to trace the eye on the temporary markings. That means we must see that the patient is exact, the patient's pupil is exactly at the fitting cross, or vice versa. Fitting cross should exactly match the pupillary center. And wearer must look through the near reference circle while reading completely, so that he the complete strong adhesion will act on the near reference circle. After that, if you are ensuring this, then erase the markings. Ask the patient to feel the distance, intermediate, as well as near vision quality. This quality check can be done very easily. You just ask the patient to wear it, look outside of your store to check for his distance vision. Look at the desktop screens if available or at your store to check for intermediate vision. And for near vision, you may simply ask the patient to keep keep his mobile in front of his eyes and check for near vision, or you may provide newspaper as well. So check for visual acuities for prescribed distance afterwards. Do not do this thing first, because sometimes what happens, you are expecting 6-9 or 6-6 visual acuity from the ready spectacles, but it may not come. So it may embrace the patient afterwards, because if the patient is feeling the vision quality is good, then he might not bother about the visual acuities. But if you will check visual acuities first, then he may have a feeling that I was expecting something which was 6-6, but it is not provided by the ready spectacles. So before checking visual acuities, practically, you must ask the patient to feel the vision quality in the real life situations. These are some practical utilities. Always give a premium touch to your progressive customers. Never counsel them in a standing posture. This is although true for every case, but in case of progressives, you must let them comfortable first. Use company provided tools like applications on gadgets for simulating the real-time vision and save for selection of the design. These are some tools like Zeiss, Essilor, Nova, and Nikon. Real-time simulated vision, like the they uses camera of your gadgets or of your device, and by using that camera or gadgets, they just check for the real-time vision, like whatever the distance zone will look like, the vision through distance zone will look like, vision through intermediate, and vision through a near zone will look like. So the patient is well experienced that yes, this will be the final outcome of a ready lens. So you can use that simulated real-time vision by using these company provided tools. Or one more thing, that you must not go through each and every designs, because then first, being an optometrist, you must know whatever the requirements are. Suppose there are A to F designs are available, A, B, C, D, A, F. So depending upon the requirements, you must select first two, like you have selected C and D designs. Now, just using these tools, you compare design C with design D. If you will compare design A to design F, every design, then it will make difficulties to the patient. It will confuse the patient's mind, and hence may land up into difficulties to you as well. Fancy terms used by companies like Pupil Intelligent Technology should not influence you as an optometrist. Instead, you should go with the details of the design. Sometimes companies use this is a pupil intelligent design and all these fancy terms. Instead of relying on these terms, you must go through the detail of the design. For that, you must know whatever the upgradations on the availabilities, market availabilities are there. And depending upon that, you must select a specific design, one or two, for the patient's requirement. Be a good listener and then counsel them by featuring the best for them. be positive while speaking about the adaptability of progressives. Let the consumer experience the quality and sense for the vision through the classes. See, these two points are correlated with each other. What happens generally, if a patient comes to us, we just say it will take 2 to 3 days to adapt. You may feel digging appearance if you will walk through the staircase using your new pair of progressive lenses. So these type of language, this type of sayings should be avoided. Always use positive languages. Like, I know you might be thinking that a patient may not come fall into an accident like walking through a staircase because of digging appearance, because of adaptation time, he may fall down. Instead, you might say that use these new pair of spectacles indoors for initial 3 to 4 days. And if you feel uncomfortable even after that, you may visit our store so that we can help you out. So these are the positive points. Or also let the patient experience the quality and the sense of vision through the glasses. Let him experience the distance, intermediate and near vision through the glasses. Next, always maintain a record book of the ordered forms. Get a digital and premium feedback from the customers. Feedback form must be asked at the time of delivery as well as 10 days later, because 10 days later only they will provide you the real feedback about the vision which he or she may experience glasses. These are the premium touch you may provide to the to your progressive consumers. Box, Selvet, sprays, then a letter for thanking, being grateful for purchasing with us. You can provide a special offers designed custom according to you and your consumers. You may provide coupon codes. You may also provide free services, like whatever the services are there, adjusting nose pads, replacing nose pads, adjusting temples, loosening of frame can be tightened in a free of cost. So these all attract the consumers to your outlet, and these all are the premium touch, basic premium touch you can provide. Never hesitate to shoot the trouble. Trouble generally arises because of two reasons. It may be because of adaptability, it may be because of errors. Adaptability, again, if you have not judged the motivation correctly, if you have not provided certain education points to the consumers, you might not have understood the expectations, and you might not have gone through the occupation and hobbies. That is why we say that history taking and conversation skills are very, very important, and that plays a very vital role in case of adaptability. Second reason is source of errors. Source of errors may be because of fitting height, inappropriate fitting heights, monocular PDs, switched lenses, or wrong power and axis. These all are the things which may come from the very initial while taking measurement to the ending till fitting. These all 4 points should be considered. The source of error is basically these 4 points. So now just coming up to the troubleshooting of the patient. If the patient comes up with the blurry distance vision, this may be because of fitting height is too high. That is why the patient is looking through the inappropriate segment or not through the distance zone. He might have been seeing through the intermediate zone. So in this case, we need to open the nose pad for sake of lowering the frame on the nose and hence allowing the eye to look through the distance portion. Now, if the patient is coming with swimming sensation, we need to look for incorrect PDs or height, or it may be because of inadequate pentascopic tilt, facial wrap, or adaptation problems. See, initial 3 points indicates that the patient is looking through somewhere from the unwanted peripheral astigmatism blur zone. The fourth issue may be because the patient is not well trained till now for being a head mover. Instead, still he is moving his eyes more and ultimately looking through the peripheral blur. So in this case, we need to increase facial wrap. Increasing facial wrap will ultimately widen the PDs. Pentascopic tilt will again make the frame come closer to the eyes and asking the patient to not looking through the peripheral blur zone. If the patient comes with blur near vision, it may be because of fitting height is too low or inadequate pentascopic tilt is there. So in this case, we need to bring in the nose pad just opposite to blur distance vision issue which we have faced. So bringing in the nose pad will raise the frame on the face, and ultimately the patient will look through the near portion. Then reading area is too small. This is because of incorrect PDs or fitting height is too low. In this case, we need to adjust the frames. If the patient is saying that he has to look to the side to read, again, this is because the patient is looking through the peripheral unwanted astigmatism. This is because of incorrect PDs or swapping of lenses, which is very rare, but it occurs. So in this case, there is no other option. We need to refit lenses. Only the available option is coming with the round shaped frames having symmetrical shape. In this case, we might have an option to switch the lenses again. Then having the tilt, having to tilt head too far back to read, this again indicates about incorrect PD, or the addition is too weak so that he is again have to move low eyes more lower by Dawes eye head phenomenon. If the patient will look tilt his head backward, then the eye will fall slightly lower. So lower than the near reference point, near reference circle, that will provide him the sufficient add, may provide insufficient add, which is which was not provided at NRC point. So this indicates that the addition is too weak. So in this case, again, we need to bring in the nose pad in order to raise the frame on the face. Having to tilt head backward for distance, it occurs because of uncorrected hyperope or overcorrected myope. So uncorrected hyperope, why? Or overcorrected hyperope, why? Because in case of uncorrected hyperope, he might have to tilt head backward again to get the eyes doll height phenomenon, which will make the eyes lower and look through more addition, more plus point, so that he might have the proper viewing area. So in this case, we need to repeat the refraction and refit the lenses. Now, if the patient is having to tilt head back forward to read, this means the add is too strong. We might have not refracted him correctly, and we need to repeat the refraction and refit the lenses. The last is having to tilt head forward for distance. This may be because of fitting height is too high, so that the patient has to bring his head forward and eye move upward, so that he is seeing through the area above the fitting cross. Basically, the exactly fitting cross is above to it. So in this case, again, we need to open the nose pad in order to lower the frame. This is all the frame adjustment we can do in this case. See, these are the basic trouble the patient can come up with. You may in practice feel different type of troubles as well. So the basic concept of solving and understanding the problem remains same. We just need to focus on all these problems, outcomes of the solutions which we will do at that point. So these all are the product availabilities. Nikon Progressives comes with the name of Precio DigiLife, Home and Office Neo, Online Wide Neo. These all are the treatments: Crizal UV, Crizal Sapphire UV, Crizal Prevention. Though it is not available nowadays, this is an older price list. Hoya Summit Pro CD Wide Amplitude Short and Regular. The treatments, the coatings are HVP and HVLL, HVLL Blue Control. Then this is Zeiss Light Portfolio, Precision Portfolio. The coatings are like Lotutech, DuraVision Silver, DuraVision Platinum, Essilor Verilux Series, Verilux Physio, Crizal UV and Crizal Sapphire UV. Treatments we need to know, and treatments we need to explain it properly, not only in case of progressive, but in case of everything. We need to know that which coating will have more benefits and which coating will have less benefits. So as you increase the level of treatment, the cost will also increase. So if we talk about the success key means we have to go through systematic approach. Any single point missed out or deviated from the systematic approach may lead to fighting at the end. Fighting is the patient may not be comfortable. He might think that you are not understanding his troubles which he has come up with, and because the progressives are premium and premium end products. Again and again, I'm mentioning that progressives are premium end products. So patient will definitely expect the services which you are going to give him, or the things which you are going to understand by his sayings. So you must not need to do these things. You must focus that the patient as well as you becomes happy at the end. So this should be the end you must expect and you must work for. So boosting your practice, successful dispensing of progressives at your outlet boost your level of confidence, which can never be achieved by a successful single vision or bifocal dispensing. You can relate this example by if you have passed class standard 5th, standard 6th in your era, you might have seen that if you have come up with 90% marks in class 5th, then the level of happiness you have and your family has. And same if you pass 90% boards with 90% 10th or 12th class, the level of happiness. Similar, because the matrix of class 12th and the matrix of class 5th differs. Matrix of class 12th is quite complex. And hence, if you pass something which is quite complex with better things, you will have a confidence built in you. So because the matrix of dispensing progressive is quite complex, when compared to other kinds, you will have a confidence if you will perform successful dispensing. Then if you have achieved mastery in dispensing progressives, it will upgrade your practice definitely by boosting your confidence. These all are my references which I have taken help with from, and thank you. It was a great opportunity from four of them. You may feel free to add any suggestions, and I'm here to answer the questions you have. Thank you.
That was a wonderful presentation, Jitesh.
Thank you.
Sure, our audience have also enjoyed it. And thank you for your time and what knowledge you have imparted on us. Okay, now this is the time of question and answer session. But I am not able to see any questions in chat box. So I would like to ask your experience with this, if you want to add something or if you want to say something.
Okay. My experience was excellent as far as For Optum is considered. For Optum provides an excellent, unique platform for students like us to build our confidence, because presentations are like a different section itself. We might not feel comfortable if we do not present more and more. So For Optum platform is very good for the students like us. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Jitesh, for your kind words. On that note, we are at the end of the session. And I would like to thank our audience for being supportive, interactive, and attentive. We'll be back with more programs and sessions. Meanwhile, please like the video, subscribe to our channel. You can also visit us at www.foroptum.com and also follow us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp. Stay home, stay safe, and have a good day.
Thanks.